Hey, yo, guys. How's it going? Sally here. And today we are sitting with my man, Jamie. He's went and done it again, with an even better deck this time. Jamie, man, what did you do?
Topped the regionals with Mermail.
You topped the regionals with Mermail. So, without any further ado, in fact, further ado, guys, like and subscribe. Alright, like and subscribe. We're almost at 800 already. Jamie wants you to like and subscribe.
Smash the like button.
Smash it. Fire right in my man.
Alright. So, obviously it's been a while, so I'll give like a brief explanation on a lot of these cards. So, Megalo. 3 Megalo, really great card. Some people play it to 2, but I played it for 3 because it was just important to open it. So, tribute your 2, or discard your 2 water monsters from hand to activate its effect to summon it, and then it can search one of the Abyss equipped spells. Now, obviously we don't have Sekka's anymore,
and what I realised is that Sekka's Light was holding the deck back. Worst card, holding the deck back, sort of thing, but no. Once we started developing the deck, after Sekka's Light, we discovered a lot more stopping power with the end board. Mm-hmm. So, 3 Megalo.
3 Teus. Mm-hmm. So Teus is one of the best cards in the deck. Unfortunately, he's not conveniently searchable, but when you open him up, he's part of the combo that I showed off earlier. You still do it in this deck. So when you summon him by his discard effect, he can search your level 4 lower Mermail. For our Mermail package as well, we're playing 1 Pike. 1 Mander, which is part of making your Calamities combo, and we're playing 2 Gund. Where's the other one going? Sorry, one of those. There is. So we're playing 2 Gund. This, however, did become debatable. After the event, I realised that I probably want to cut Gund just to 1 and throw in Monster Reborn, just because in this deck, there's ways of putting
Prince in Grave and then just going a bit nuts with that and just making a lot of extenders. I never felt like I needed the 2 Gund. So, 1 will probably be the go-to.
1 Mauling Glacier. 2 Deep Sea Diva. 3 Neptubus Prince. 3 Dragoons. Now, one of the things I had going for me is not a lot of people really knew when to stop Mermail, or really how to. And I even had one guy sided out Droll against me, which single-handedly kills this deck. But one of the most impactful things that would happen to me is when this got hit by Call by the Grave. At the right time, that was fairly devastational. Now we're playing 1 Heavy Infantry. No Marksman, despite there being a lot of control this format. This was really just here to essentially turn your Abelacia into a Dryden. If you opened up any of your other cards from the combo without needing to search them off Dragoons, and you either open this or one of your other combo pieces, then you would also end with your enemy board with a Dryden under a lot of situations. So a quick crap pop. 1 Lapis Dragon, just a really nice easy extender. It also helps you go straight into cards like your Brianna. But yeah, it's just a free extender, easy summon tuner when it's searched. So this went in and out and in and out, which was our 3 Undyne and Controller. After Sekka's went down, I initially took this away because not being able to shuffle the controller back makes this card more of a brick than ever. However, what this was just another combo starter. This, Pike, Prince, Diva, 1-for-1, all of these sort of cards just let you start going into your plays and going into your combo. So eventually he did end up staying in the deck. When you did draw this, it sucked. There wasn't a lot you could use it for except discarding off of Nightmares, but it was a very good starter, so it did end up making the cut. We're still playing 3 Swap Frog and 1 Toad. Fairly self-explanatory, just part of going into early board. None of the Mermail effects really get triggered off of them except for Gund, and there were actually plenty of times where you could set your grave up a certain way and revive one of your Mermails back by pitching the Gund off swap, which is pretty much the only effect that will trigger off of it. So for the event, I also played 3 Drone Lockbird. Now this is the only hand trap that I play. Now I was loaning my Imperms to my mate Sean, who, shout out to him for winning the regional. So my cards came in lucky for him, but I was playing 3 Drone. Didn't actually come up a huge amount. I thought I would see it more. I would have been playing 3 Impermanents. But this is sort of the intermittent spot. Because this is going first as a deck, you want to see enough of your extenders and star cards. You want to see as many water monsters in your hand as possible. So I really thinned down the hand traps, and I essentially approached it with almost a siding mentality of, you know, if I go first, I want to focus on making my board. I'm not too fussed about the hand traps. If I go second, I want to see the hand traps are going to be most impactful. And the toughest matchup for me is Spiral. Hero as well, because Darklaw is almost impossible to out. So the Droll was good for that. Three Call by the Grave, fairly self-explanatory. It was there to dodge Droll. This deck does have a very big weakness to Droll, and I got lucky that most people had removed it for Imperm instead. This came up a few times, but more often than not, I would end up setting it. Just after I'd made my board, I would set this and use it to thin away other parts of their play. I've notoriously never been good at drawing Call by the Grave when I'm getting hand trapped. So three instant fusion. We are playing a cross sheet build, which just took this deck to a whole other level, because when you see this, you immediately just do a lot more, because any of your rank 4 plays, when you detach them as cost, if you detach Dragoons as cost to activate the effects of Bahamut Shark or Abyss Dweller, Dragoon still gets its search. So this was just a mad plus extender. Once you just made your board, you just linked away your dead cards and just then made an instant fusion play and either ended on Dweller or Toad, which was always super impactful. One for one. Fairly self-explanatory. You pretty much just summon Prince, and having that normal summon spare just means that you could send the Prince and off the Dragoon search from it. You could add something like Deep Sea Diva, summon that, and summon out another Sea Serpent. It was just a lot of extender plays with it, and it was just another way to get to the combos. And then the last card, probably my favourite card, and the whole reason that I do not miss Sekka's Light, was the Mizuchi equip card. This card has the ability to negate Super Poly, Dark Ruler No More. It's pretty mad.
Yeah, this one's pretty nuts, and people are sleeping on it.
Yeah, absolutely. I think people are sleeping on this deck in general. You know, it's not as consistent as other top tier contenders like Rockets and so on, and it's not going to be that style of deck. But some of the boards I was ending on, you know, routinely, if I went uninterrupted, I could end on Appaloosa with three negates, a Toad, an Ablaze with a pop, rip two cards out your hand and have the spell equipped negate. Even if your hand didn't really pop off, you didn't go absolutely nuts, you would still end on Calamity's Ablacia, Calamity's Appaloosa. There's so many options. The deck's very versatile. It doesn't need to end on the same board. If you're in a more spell-heavy or control-heavy matchup, then you have the cards to set up your going first board, more like going for your Toad, your Mizuchi and so on, because negating Extravagance is also incredibly relevant, because they're going to play it anyway, and it just immediately makes their hand just that bit less.
Yeah, start with 4 card hands.
Yeah, and especially as well when you hit them with a Mowing Glacier. You know, there's a lot of people would side in things like Dark Ruler No More against me because the boards I would end on were so extreme that they would think that or Super Poly was the best bet. Not so much Super Poly because Mud Dragon's really the only thing that can get me. But especially in the final, I remember I was playing a hero player, a really nice guy. I do my full combo, rip the cards out of his hand, end on 101 negates me, not that as much. And he draws the Dark Ruler No More, and he was just very upset because I looked at it, the equip spell was on the board, and there was nothing he could really do.
Mm-hmm.
So onto the Esh deck. One Mud Dragon. I went for Mud Dragon over Rare Fish, and it almost could be an irritant. So because this is a worm, you can't actually use it to make your, in a pinch, you wouldn't be able to make a play like linking into your Ablacia, because that requires Sea Serpents, Fish and Aqua. So there was maybe an argument to play Rare Fish. But if you set this up early in your turn, if you wanted to make an early cross sheet play, which would give you the ability to extend further, then this could, quite funnily enough, then you could just give yourself a bit of targeting protection. But overall, it was just better, and it means if I ever do want to play with Super Poly in the deck, which, depending on the format, I might, it's just a nice, easy Super Poly target to have. One cross sheet, really good card, speaks for itself. Pretty much any deck that can force it in will force it in at the moment. Being able to bring back such crucial rank 4 water monster plays was really refreshing, because for as long as I've been playing the deck, I've often tried by putting things in like Aqua Spirit and so on, but it just never ends out being worth it. But this really made it worth all the while, because this is pretty much Norden. And Norden, as you might remember, was a pretty good card. One Mask Arena. This was really hard to fit in. I really wanted to put it in, and what I ended up doing is I cut the Gaios, which I've been going back and forth on for a while. So I removed my last rank 7 play, which will probably upset a lot of Mermail players. But the IP Mask Arena, there was just a lot of times when, again, if you couldn't make Appaloosa on your turn because you wanted to hold on to the spell negate and the pop search with Ablacia, you would link away your other materials, so you'd have IP Mask Arena, Ablacia, and Toad or Calamities or whatever else it was you ended on. And then this would just be so threatening that most of the time they would pick up. One Ablacia. Best card in the deck, if not a bit slow. I really wish that they just said, yeah, you can just do this during either player's turn for the search. But no, it's during your opponent's turn. So if you've got heavy infantry in hand, it's pretty much turns this card into Dryden. And when you have this equipped with Mizuchi, you're almost playing sort of a protect the castle kind of deck, because this can search one of the best cards in your deck with Teus, the spell negate, the attack buff, boosting the attack of things around it as well. It's just a very versatile, good card. It was very rare for me to make a board that I didn't have this. Coral Anemone mostly would come up if you'd Brit in some way, but there were a lot of plays like reviving a Swap Frog and just being able to make your Toad. This does lock you into water monsters, so you either do this when you brick and you just need to set up some form of negation, or you would make this in sort of your mid game when you'd already done everything else and you just wanted to push a little further with an extended. One Phoenix, speaks for itself, control matchup, weakness. Unicorn, again, same thing. There were times when I would shuffle my own cards away as well to make things live, which was always quite interesting. BLS, this card just wins you so many matches. It's an absolute finisher of a boss monster, and I did end up playing this over Barload and never regret that decision. Rank 4 plays were fairly rare, to say the least. One Appaloosa appeared on 60% of my ending boards, and the only time it really wasn't appearing on the board is if I made a Mascarena play instead, or if I'd bricked and I only ended on a couple of negates instead. One Barrel Sword, because just for a rapid finish. Brionac, again, it still triggers a lot of your Atlantean effects and so on. Easy to get out with Lapis Dragon, so maybe it doesn't come up a huge amount, but in control matchups, if you've got their whole board set away, this can force a lot of reactions, because if you've got two or three cards in hand and you activate this and target all the back row, you pretty much will get everything out of the way very quickly. So he's quite vital in the control matchup. And then one Toad, one Dweller, one Bahamut Shark, and one Calamitous. A lot of people were really surprised to see this come up as much as it did. But because your hand was quite reliant on drawing Teus and Dragoons to do like the full vital combo, it would often seem like it wasn't coming up a huge amount. But at the very first round, game one, I drew, I think it was Teus, Dragoons, Called by the Grave, Instant Fusion, and something like Heavy Infantry, and I felt really bad for the guy because it was a very terrifying board, but I knew that everything was going to be okay and we were going to top that one. So that's the extra.
Yep.
So for our side, we had two Lightning Storm.
By the way, just I'm going to be really gentle with this one, just to flex on you all. There it is.
Can't really see it under the dark there.
Okay. It's a Starlight rare. Okay.
There we go. That worked. No. My phone dead. There you go.
Oh, there it is. Yup. Oh, God, I'm poor.
So, two Lightning Storm. Would have played three, but I had another one on lend to Pavan, and we did this for him. We topped with Mermail for Pavan. Two Twin Twister. This was a very last minute change. This was at the start of the day, two Dark Ruler No More, and I'd printed my deck list out in advance. But I was like, if I see Mystic Mind today, I have so few outs, and I've got so much stopping power as it is. I'm just going to cut the two Dark Ruler and put in two Twin Twister. Best decision I made. It came up so many times, and I probably wouldn't have topped if I hadn't made that call. One Red Reboot, and three of the match. Red Reboot is just too good not to play when you've got the space. Against Guru or Altergeist or Trapstun or anything like that, this card can lock them out and then you'll easily OTK. So we had a lot of answers here for the control matchups, but as well with things like Evenly and Lightning Storm being good in generic matchups as well, I never felt like I was giving them too much space at all. So then we went for the three Sanctum and a Scythe. No D barrier, mostly because this deck has a very strong matchup against Shadal and Gold. So I didn't feel enough need, and a lot of the time when I was going first, it was so easy. It was so easy for me to pop off because a lot of people were playing Imperm, which does very, very little against me. The times when I did side this in, I think I only resolved it once or twice, but I just preferred this over D-Barrier, because It stopped me losing to things like Spiral if they drolled me, because they will still play Drolled. If I got Drolled, I could still end on Abelacia live in hand with the set Sanctum. So I preferred that for Debagger for this thing. And then 3-Rock. I never used it, and it never got dropped on me. I'm not sure what happened. Only time I even saw it was when I drew it for turn, which we all know is the best time
to draw. Yeah.
The only time the to only draw time. Nibiru. Well, my man, as usual, you're bringing the absolute spice to the channel. It's so good to see you. I've not seen Jamie in so long. He's as handsome as ever. Look at him there. Guys, let's take it to the outro. So as always, if you like it, give it a like. And if you love it, give it a share and tell everyone you know about Team Tally today. Do it all the time, but this guy, he's in Team Tally. I'm in Team Tally, and you should be too by clicking subscribe down there. As always, you've been amazing. I've been Tally. I'll catch you later. Bye.